Prologue. Winifred Portly Rind made a point of taking a very long walk every afternoon down the narrow, deep streets of Cheesebridge. She called it her daily consensual and claimed it was for her health. But actually, 11-year-old Winnie was bored. School was moderately uninteresting and home was excessively tedious. Winnie's father was Cheesebridge's leading citizen, which made him excruciatingly dull. And Winnie's mother, who was obsessed with clothes, clothes and more clothes, an outfit for virtually every hour of the day. And that, of course, was colossally tiresome. And so the Daily Consensual was born, and Winnie escaped the monotony for several hours. There was only one problem with her tragedy. The village of Cheesebridge was pretty humdrum itself. In fact, as every man, woman, and child knew, there were 364 perfectly normal days in Cheesebridge, each and every year. And then there was Trubshaw Baby Day. Now that day was anything but dull. Along the narrow sidewalk of Buttery Street, most merchants had some sort of sign or banner counting down to Trubshaw Baby Day. As Winnie strolled past the Wheel of Fortune gift shop, a freshly spruced up flag fluttered in the wind, announcing, "Only 3 days to TBD." 3 days, Winnie thought. And then the town would come to life. There would be parades, special performers, feasts, bonfires, theatrics, fireworks, raffles, and a gala ball, all to solemnly commemorate the gruesome day almost 10 years ago when the little Trubshaw baby disappeared and presumably was killed by creatures that lived underneath Cheesebridge, the box trolls. The maze-like streets and alleys, along with sat high, narrow homes and shops, were all close packed together. Even on a long walk, one could get only so far. "Good morning, Miss Portly Rind," called a waiter from the doorway of Chez Fromage, one of the town's fancier restaurants. "Good morning, Jean Louise," Winnie replied. "Only 3 days to go. Are you excited?" Jean Louise asked. "Wildly excited, to say the least," Winnie called over her shoulder as she continued to walk. And it was true. Winnie was excited, but not as much as she'd been last year, and again the year before that. Because having living through exactly 9 Trubshaw baby days so far, the first 2 or 3 were a bit of a blur. She found that some of the thrill had recently gone out of it. Winnie wasn't quite sure why. It seemed to be a combination of things. For starters, Winnie had begun to wonder why a day commemorating a tragic abduction and murder was the subject of celebration. Maybe I'm just strange, Winnie thought. But when I think about the tragic loss of a tiny baby, the first things that come to mind are dancing, feasting, parading, souvenir hawking, or general all-out partying. Yes, that was probably part of the problem, Winnie decided. But there was more to it than that. And the older she got, the more she felt it. Winnie wasn't just bored with her life. She was, in fact, aching for some excitement, for something different, for some real-life danger. For as long as Winnie could remember, there had been a curfew in Cheesebridge. After darkness had fallen each night, shops were closing down and people retreated to their homes, where they triple-locked their doors and shuttered their windows. The things that had taken the Trubshaw baby, as everyone knew, came out of their death cave only at night, to roam the streets in search of fresh victims. And what sounded excessively dangerous, to be sure. However, after the Trubshaw baby, no one else of note had disappeared from Cheesebridge. The man taking credit for that was the creepily repulsive Archibald Snatcher, who patrolled the streets with his team of red hats. So named for the red hats they almost never took off. Snatcher said his patrol was so intimidating that the monsters had been forced to hunt in other towns. In short, Snatcher had made commuters of them. Whenever they did appear in Cheesebridge, and there were people who claimed to have seen them, The Red Hats pursue them and either exterminate them or drove them back to their death cave. But in almost 10 years, you'd think the monsters would have killed at least one other Cheeseburgian, Winnie mused. Or I didn't know taking a few bites out of one. And yet, she could not think of another person who had gone missing. It wasn't that she didn't believe in the monsters. She most certainly did. She had been taught all about them and about the Trubshaw baby for years, both at school and at home. Adults didn't make up with things like that. No, the monsters were very real. So the only explanation, Winnie decided, is that Snatcher is right. Whenever the monsters come looking for a meal in Cheesebridge, the Red Hats take care of the situation before any violence could occur. Winnie knew she ought to be thankful for that. Snatcher certainly made no secret of his belief that every man, woman, and child should spend the better part of each day being thankful for the protection and vigilance of Archibald P. Snatcher. But as Winnie's curls bounced past yet another cheese shop, she knew that all calm and no murderer made Cheesebridge a dull town. There had to be more to life than the cheese gold, and getting cheese, or tasting cheese, or hearing about cheese. There had to be something beyond the countdown to Trubshaw Baby Day and Winnie's daily consensual. One day, when I'm old enough, I'll travel, Winnie told herself. I'll leave Cheesebridge and see the sights, have some adventures, live dangerously. I'll be a fearless explorer and battle monsters and save people from awful things, and everyone will love me, and I'll wear the same thing every day, and I won't ever have to put on another itchy dress or frilly shirt with puffed sleeves, not for the rest of my life. The thought of it made Winnie feel a little better, but only a little. She knew she was still only a kid. It would be a long time before she was old enough to pack up and begin her travels. But I'll do it, she silently promised, because there has to be something else out there. Something different, something totally unknown. And I'm going to find it, even if I have to travel halfway across the world. Winnie tripped over something and almost fell. Darn it, she exclaimed. In the midst of her daydreaming, she had absent-mindedly wandered from the sidewalk and into the street. She looked down and saw she had just caught her foot on the lip of a manhole cover that was ever so slightly dislodged. I must be more careful, she told herself. I don't want to get run over by a truck, but because before I've so much as gone a toe near some place other than Cheesebridge. Winnie stepped back onto the sidewalk and picked up her pace a little. Seconds later, when there was a quick clanking noise and the manhole cover suddenly dropped back into place. Winnie was too far away to hear it or to notice anything out of the ordinary happening where she had just been standing. Something had moved it from below.